distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the parish of Christchurch St. Lawrence, I warmly welcome you to this service of solemn evensong, giving thanks for the coronation of His Majesty King Charles III and Her Majesty Queen Camilla. This evening, we are very honoured to welcome His Excellency, the Honourable Andrew Bell, Lieutenant Governor of New South Wales. Your Excellency, we are honoured by your presence with us this evening. I welcome all who are visiting from other churches and communities of faith, and I hope that this act of worship will be a very great blessing to you as we pray for our new King and our nation. I invite you to remain standing as we come before God in prayer.
And your glory shall show forth, and pray. the first lesson. Here beginneth the 16th chapter of the first book of Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul, seeing I have rejected him from being king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and go. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." And Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord,' and invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me him whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, trembling, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" And he said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." And Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen these." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but behold, he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he comes here." And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. And the Lord says, "Arise, anoint him, for this is he." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Here endeth the first lesson.
Thank you. Here beginneth the eighth verse of the 21st chapter of the Revelation of St. John the Divine. Then came one of the seven angels, who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues, and spoke to me, saying, Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And in the Spirit he carried me away to a great high mountain, and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, its radiance like a most rare jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. It had a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and on the gates the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel were inscribed. On the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, on the south 3 gates, and on the west 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine upon it, for the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light shall the nations walk, and the kings of the earth shall bring their glory into it. And its gates shall never be shut by day, and there shall be no night there. They shall bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations. Here endeth the second lesson.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. From the 16th chapter of the first book of Samuel. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed David in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Obscene, irrelevant, absurd. Just a few of the adjectives being thrown around in the mainstream media to describe the coronation service of His Majesty King Charles III. Coronations inspire and unite, but for as long as they have existed, coronations have also generated division, criticism, and conflict. The coronation that took place yesterday at Westminster Abbey has perhaps attracted more criticism than many of its predecessors. After all, you and I are living in an increasingly secular and multicultural society. Many commentators have openly suggested that coronations have absolutely no place in our modern world. Now, please remain calm when I say this. I agree that coronations have no place in our modern secular world because, like every other act of worship, they are speaking of another world entirely. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed David in the midst of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. When David is made king by Samuel, it was considered a most unlikely choice. The Israelites needed a robust warrior as their king, but the Lord chose this shepherd boy, the youngest of eight brothers, not because of his formidable experience or his towering intellect, but we are told he was chosen because of what was in his heart. David is then anointed by Samuel, affirming that he has a unique vocation, a unique role to play in God's plan for humankind. Anointing is not usually part of an inauguration or an investiture. These are important civic events, but they never claim to be sacred. An elected leader will promise to serve the people entrusted to their care. And this is being a good leader, and you and I know that our world desperately needs good leaders at the moment. However, by coming before God in prayer and by being anointed, a sovereign goes much further than this. A sovereign also promises to serve God as well as God's people. Now, yesterday, immediately after he was welcomed to Westminster Abbey by a child, His Majesty affirmed all of this as he spoke his first words in the service, "In his name and after his example, I come not to be served, but to serve." At yesterday's coronation service, and I'm guessing you all watched it, much was made of the liturgy of anointing, the most solemn moment of the ancient coronation ritual. However, none of the commentary I heard really succeeded in making sense of this most profound moment in the liturgy. It was hidden from us, and most people didn't go anywhere near in trying to explain it. Dating back to biblical times,
the anointing of the monarch remains an unworldly tradition that has somehow survived religious and social upheaval, a liturgical tradition that is treated with the utmost dignity and respect. And so yesterday, magnificent screens were carried in to conceal this ancient ritual, a liturgical manoeuvre undertaken with such military precision that it would have warmed the heart of even the fussiest Anglo-Catholic. It was magnificent, and yet the act of anointing is not nearly as rare as some would imagine. You may be utterly shocked and surprised to know that most of us here in this church tonight have also been anointed. Perhaps not behind a screen in Westminster Abbey, but a liturgical gesture of equal significance. Whenever a child is brought to that font at the back of this church and others like it, the priest baptizes with water before anointing with oil, making the sign of the cross on the child's forehead. And as the newly baptized is anointed, the priest says, "I sign you with the sign of the cross to show that you are marked as Christ's own forever." This is another ancient ritual that, of course, has no place in this modern secular world. Regardless of its context or its location, anointing with oil affirms that although we are of this world, our eyes are firmly fixed on another world entirely. It affirms that we have all been entrusted with a truly unique vocation. We have all been called to build up God's kingdom on earth with whatever skills and talents we have been given, until we claim our citizenship in heaven. With all of you here tonight, I rejoice that His Majesty King Charles III has not simply pledged to be a good leader, but that, like his late mother, the King makes no apologies for his Christian faith, while respecting people of all faith traditions and none. In front of the entire world, His Majesty has now affirmed that above everything else, he is a child of God. He has affirmed that God has entrusted him with a unique vocation, a vocation of duty and service. With all of you, I hope and pray that His Majesty King Charles will continue to be led in the ways of holiness, that he will always model his leadership on the one who came not to be served, but to serve. And I pray that after a long and prosperous reign, His Majesty King Charles will also be rewarded with life in that other world, that other kingdom, an eternal kingdom of justice, love, and peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord our God, who upholdest and governest all things by the word of thy power, receive our humble prayers for our sovereign Lord Charles, as at this time anointed, crowned, and set over us by thy grace and providence to be our King. And together with him, bless, we beseech thee, Queen Camilla, William, Prince of Wales, the Princess of Wales, and all the royal family, that they, ever trusting in thy goodness, protected by thy power, and crowned with thy gracious and endless favour, may long continue before thee in peace and safety, joy and honour, and after death may obtain everlasting life and glory, by the merits and mediation of Christ Jesus our Saviour, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth, ever one God, world without end. Amen. Almighty God, who rulest over all the kingdoms of the world, and dost order them according to thy good pleasure, we yield thee unfeigned thanks for that thou wast pleased as at this time to anoint and crown thy servant, our sovereign Lord Charles, as the king of this realm. Let thy wisdom be his guide, and let thine arm strengthen him. Let truth and justice, holiness and righteousness, peace and charity abound in his days. Direct all his counsels and endeavours to thy glory and the welfare of his subjects. Give us grace to obey him cheerfully for conscience' sake, and let him always possess the hearts of his people. Let his reign be long and prosperous, and crown him with everlasting life in the world to come. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord our Governor, whose glory is in all the world, we commend this nation, the Commonwealth of Australia, to thy merciful care, that being guided by thy providence, we may dwell secure in thy peace. Grant to thy servants, David, the Governor General of Australia, Margaret, the Governor of New South Wales, and Andrew, Lieutenant Governor of New South Wales, wisdom and strength to know and to do thy will. Endue with wisdom and strength the ministers of the Crown, the parliaments of this land, and all who are set in authority. Grant them so to use the power entrusted to them for thy honour and glory, that righteousness and peace may be established among us for all generations. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, our only Saviour, the Prince of Peace, give us grace seriously to lay to heart the great dangers we are in by our unhappy divisions. Take away all hatred and prejudice, and whatsoever else may hinder us from godly union and concord, that, as there is but one body and one spirit and one hope of our calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, so we may henceforth be all of one heart and of one soul, united in one holy bond of truth and peace, of faith and charity, and may with one mind and one mouth glorify thee, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.